Hello, fishing friends. Welcome to another episode of The Fishing Podcast. I'm your host, Landon DeKaiser, and this is where I interview industry greats, average Joes and Janes, biologists, conservationists, and everything in between. My goal is simple. I want to inspire anglers to catch more fish, more places, more often. All right, on today's episode, I've got Jake Ruedisale of Two Track Custom Rods and my cousin Dustin Nichols. We go over to Jake's house to talk about his rod building business, how he does what he does, and some of the process that goes into making these rods. So I had no idea how much time it took to build a fishing rod, period. Any fishing rod, there's a absolute tremendous amount of time that goes into it and attention to detail. And then when you add to that the artistic work that goes into a custom rod like the ones Jake makes, it can really take some time. And he is very, very detail oriented. He's very good at what he does. And I would highly encourage you to check out his work if you are thinking about getting a custom rod done. Now, a lot of people are like, what's the point in having a fancy rod like that? Well, you know what? It looks cool and I like it. And if I'm going to spend that much time fishing, why not have something that you like that looks nice? It's the same thing as a car. We could all drive a 20-year-old car that had rust holes in the side of it and we'd still get to work in that car. But why not have something that looks nice that you can enjoy while you're using it? And on top of that, the cost to do a custom rod is actually quite affordable when you're building higher end rods, because the higher end rods already cost a significant amount of money. And if you're going to have a custom one done, you'd actually be surprised as to the cost difference to customize something and have it be just your own design. And you can tweak things if there's things you don't like about your current rod or add certain features. It's really, you can have whatever you want. We also talk about some of our past fishing adventures, future fishing adventures, and what we're going to be doing to catch steelhead the upcoming weekend, which technically would have been last weekend now, but a lot of that will still apply to the rest of the season. If you haven't got out and went steelhead fishing yet, now is the time. The rivers pretty much everywhere have fish in them and are getting more numbers by the day. So get out there and give it a try if you haven't. If you've been procrastinating, don't wait, because man, steelhead fishing can come and go faster than I can ever believe. Sometimes we get a fast run and all the fish are gone, and sometimes it lasts for, you know, a good 2 months in the spring. But with the weather shaping up the way it has, I think that we'll have a good solid couple of weeks here, and then we might be looking for new fishing adventures as trout season opens up all of our rivers here in Michigan. Enjoy today's episode, everyone. I really appreciate you listening. Again, if you can please do me the biggest favor, give this podcast a rating on whatever platform you're listening to. So if you love it, give it a 5-star. If you hate it, leave a review and tell me what I can do better, because this podcast really is for you guys to help entertain, educate, and inspire you to get out on the water more often. And I'm hoping that I'm doing a good job of that, but I don't know unless you guys give me some feedback. So enjoy your time on the water. Here's today's episode.
So we're sitting here today in Jake's rod building factory,
AKA dungeon,
the basement, with my cousin Dustin and my number one fishing friend, hunting friend, general friend, I guess, sometimes.
Wait, I thought I was your number one hunting fishing friend.
I just said you were.
No. Hey, dude, you literally just said that.
Unless your name's not Dustin. So, Jake, tell the listeners who you are, where you're from, and what you like to do for fun.
My name's Jake Ruedisale.
Maybe not all the things you like to do for fun, but
that's
like fishing related things.
Not the best idea.
Jake has twins, if that tells you what he likes to do for fun.
What is fun at this point?
I think it was actually the day that we went mousing. I think it was like the day or the day before you were going in for an ultrasound.
Yeah.
Because we got done and you're like, yeah, I'm figuring out what I'm going to have tomorrow.
Yeah.
Boy or a girl.
We weren't planning on finding out what they were, and then walked into that room and saw two circles on that screen and went, oh, everything we said just went out the window.
So you weren't going to find out if it was a boy or a girl?
No, we were going to wait, and then twins is like, okay.
Now we need to prepare.
Yeah.
I'm sure you were well prepared by the time they got here, though, right?
To an extent. I mean, you're never ready for twins. I don't care what anybody says.
No, definitely not. I'm not even ready for one yet. So
bank your sleep now.
I don't do a good job of that.
All right.
Dustin, you've got a small child at home. How old is your kid?
She's going to be one in 2 weeks.
Okay.
So April 8th, she's going to be one.
So in general, would you recommend having kids for fishing?
I'd say have them in the off season.
I'm going to be honest. She hasn't affected my fishing.
No.
However,
must be nice.
I can't speak for twins.
Yeah.
Like I said, must be nice.
Yeah. I've got two dogs, and you know
that's hard. I think, dude, dogs are way harder than kids.
Well, they have a doggy door now, so
okay,
they let themselves in and out, and we can just leave them at home. It's awesome.
Well, that's good.
But we've only been letting them use it since it's been cold out. Now it's getting muddy outside, so
that makes it a lot harder.
I feel like they're gonna go out there and get all muddy and come in the house, and I'm gonna come home one day.
Where's the doggy door?
It's in the utility room.
Oh, okay.
Which we used to keep that closed because we had a cat yep. and a litter box in there, and
yep.
cat's gone now, so.
You're brave,
R.I.P.
dude.
R.I.P. Kit Kat.
Oh, it's a fenced-in backyard, so.
Yeah, ours is the same way, but if there's mud, our labs find it
yeah.
every single time. Every yeah. single time.
No, that's my golden retriever. If there's even an ounce of water on the ground, he's going to roll in it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, just last night, they were coming back in, and instead of going around the puddle, they both had to go right through it. And
yep.
went out of their way to go through it.
Oh, yeah.
Come on.
Makes it way more fun.
Oh, yeah.
I saw this thing online. It's like a bucket, and it has like a bunch of like rubber fingers, and you put water in there. You can dip your paws in it. I was thinking about getting one of those.
That might be a worthy investment.
Yeah. If it worked. Yeah. If it even worked a little bit, it'd be worth it.
Right. But
anyways,
easier than a wet towel.
Enough of the dog talk. So
yep.
You're a pretty avid fisherman. Fish for
to say
a lot
the least.
Of trout, steelhead,
trout,
salmon.
Salmon, steelhead, smallmouth's the one that's really starting to move up my list.
Yeah. Dustin and I do a lot of that once it warms up in the summertime.
Yeah, man, that's been one of my favorites for...
We'll have to take you to some spots over here because we can hit them after work, 3-4 hour fish.
And oh, yeah, we used to put our boat in and
float yeah, you
down
guys
to Grand
used to do
Ledge
a ton of
all,
floats
the
all the time, yeah.
Then we grew up and don't really do that anymore. My boat's been sitting there for 6 months.
Yeah, I've made a good habit of backing out on trips with you. Not necessarily backing out, but being unavailable.
Yeah.
And that's
yeah.
been a couple of
Except
them.
Except for one instance, it's all trips. Worked out really, really well for me.
Well, that's not what happened the other day. Dustin backed out. He got his first strike of the year. I allowed 2 strikes on my boat. You'd strike out twice. You're not invited. Maybe not invited, but you go to the bottom of the list.
Oh.
So...
I might have to implement that system.
But, yeah, we didn't catch
I feel like that
fish,
doesn't
so.
Count for family.
Fine, I'll give you 3.
That's fair.
If it's a non-emergency related event, you
okay.
skip.
In my defense.
You go to the back of the rotation.
In my defense, we had a very, very, very brief conversation Friday via text that led me to believe that we were not going to fish on Sunday.
Well, you should just know that I'm going to fish whether it's going to be a horrible day of fishing or not.
So
I've been out too many times.
I know that that's
not
typically...
gone out too many times and been like, oh, the river's too high, it's too muddy, there's no point in going. And then I get home and my friends went out and just crushed them.
I know, and I think about that too. But I also think about how many times we've used that philosophy and it's been... It's like... been one of the worst days ever.
Yeah.
Until we tell the story like a month or two later, and then it's funny.
Yeah. Well, like that time we were on the Kalamazoo and it was super high and muddy, and we weren't catching any fish, but those guys in front of us boated like 15 fish in an hour.
In front of us.
And then we got in our back in our kayaks and just paddled all the way
literally
out
as we floated the same run.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they were fishing golf ball size. spawn sacks, and we were fishing beads. So.
Yep, that's how my grandpa fishes down the Kalamazoo. Just a huge chunk of spawn. Just lets it sit there, wait for the rod to bounce.
It's all, that river's always dirty, but
they crush them down there.
Yeah, they do.
They do. A lot of fish in that river. It's tough fishing sometimes, but.
Oh, yeah. You can go to there one day and never touch one. The next day, like you said, boat 15. You know?
Yeah.
But it's like that just about anywhere.
Yeah.
So you do two-track custom rods.
Yep.
What kind of rods do you build?
Pretty much anything. I mean, I've done, for the most part, I'm doing a lot of float rods, you know, a lot of fly rods. I mean, I've built both of you guys a couple.
Yeah.
Ultralight spinning rods. I mean, can literally do just about anything. The one I'm really starting to get into is the Spire Wrap bait casters.
Oh, yeah.
There's not too many guys out there doing it.
Yeah, I saw one of those ones you did the other day. That looked
they're
pretty sweet.
There's a lot that goes into them, and I didn't realize it until I started building them. And that was like,
what's different, I guess, about a bait caster rod that you weren't expecting?
It's just with the spiral wrap. I mean, your guides start on the top, and then they rotate around the blank and have to end on the 180 axis or the bottom, and then you're just running your guides straight from there. It's just a way of keeping the rod itself balanced. It's more conducive to like float fishing, especially in the winter, because you can run different types of spinning guides on the bottom that help kind of reduce ice buildup, I guess.
Okay.
I don't know. It's different, but it's...
A lot of people are starting to fish with the bait casters for steelhead. Everyone I talk to really likes it.
Yeah.
I just got into the pin fishing this year, so I'm still loving that. I just love fighting a fish on a pin. It's fun.
Oh, dude, there's nothing better than a... It's one-on-one.
I mean,
you don't have a drag. You don't have anything to assist you. It's one-on-one.
Yep.
That's my favorite part about fishing with a center pin.
I feel like in cold temps with a bait caster, you'd think the line would kind of tighten up on there with how tightly it's wrapped, and you wouldn't get a great drift in the real cold temps.
Honestly, I haven't done it, so I'm not entirely sure, but you know, the biggest issue with those is, especially if you're fishing smaller streams that don't have a ton of flow. It's not going to pull your float out like you would if you're fishing the Grand or the Manistee.
Right.
Something with a, you know, they're a lot more conducive to big water, and especially for people who would, you know, have smaller hands or struggle with center pin.
Yeah.
I mean, it just kind of takes a little bit of that learning curve out of it. I mean, the other one that it's really good for is if you're, you know, skein fishing for kings or something like that. I mean, those big, hard charging, fast fish coming right at you.
Yeah.
You got a 7-to-1 pickup.
Yeah, you can get
at the
you can
worst
pick up some line really
versus,
quick.
You know, 1 or 1.5-to-1.
You know,
it makes a huge difference.
Yeah. I fished with one of my buddies. He had just picked up a bait caster setup. And, the first day he went to fish with me, I smashed it in the rod holder in my boat and he never got to use it. Brand new Fenwick. Sorry, Chance.
Ooh, I'm sure he was real happy with you that day.
You know, he was pretty cool about it. He was a lot cooler than I would have been, that's for sure. So,
yeah.
But, so I'm going to have you build another pin rod for me because everyone needs two closers. So,
if not more.
One of the main reasons I want to get the 12-footer is my boat's a 14.5-foot boat, and it's really tough to set the rod down in there.
Oh, yeah.
So I want one that's a little bit shorter for fishing out of the boat.
Right. The 12s are definitely better for fishing out of the boat.
Does your 13 even fit in the rod locker on yours?
No, you can't even put it in there.
Right.
Because it has, like, where you put the tips of the rod, like, up through some tubes, and... You could take it, you could break it down and put it in there, but
yeah,
that's kind of a pain.
Yeah, but then re-rigging a 12-foot rod in a boat.
Right,
right.
That's 14 feet. Yeah, that's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Yep. But, and I just want a cool looking rod, something that's unique.
Right.
And that's what we kind of have to figure out today is what I want done with that and all the different guides. So what are some of the guide options you can put on a center pin rod and maybe what are some of the advantages to the more expensive ones? Because I used to be kind of the kind of person that would look at something expensive and be like, that's not going to work any better than this cheap guide. and over the years I've learned differently. So what, I guess, what are people's options if they want a completely custom rod? What kind of guides do you use and what do you recommend?
For the most part, especially on closers, most of your float rods you're going to build, you know, I'm usually running recoils for the top, depending on the length of the rod, either the first 10 guides or the first 11. You know, it all kind of depends on where the spacing needs to be, you know, how it looks after a static test. I mean, those recoils are by far the most superior guides I've found for winter fishing or cold weather fishing.
And those are the guides that come on a closer exactly. if you just bought it from exactly. Land & Glass, too.
Yep. And they run Alps, far as I know, they just run Alps Y guides on the bottom, just your ceramics.
Yep.
You know, that's the hardest part about rod building, in my opinion, is the back and forth with a potential customer and trying to nail down exactly what they want. Like, the amount of options for guides that are out there, when I first started doing this, like, it hurt my brain.
Yeah.
I mean, it was absolutely overwhelming. But the good thing is the rod building community, I mean, there's so many good dudes out there that more than willing to help you out, especially if you're just getting going. I mean, I've met some of the nicest people through this, and yeah.
Well, and what you're going to use that rod for too, you know?
I mean, exactly.
When you're talking about
certain applications,
steelhead and cold weather fishing.
Exactly. Certain, you know, applications call for better guides. And
you're going to be iced up all the time.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, and the size of the guide itself. You know, you have to pay attention to that, because
if you're running
fives and sixes on the tips and you're fishing in January when it's 15 degrees outside, you're not going to have a good day.
No. Yeah. Well, even then, that was one of the things that you and I got to talking about when you were building those trout rods
right.
for us is, you know, like what kind of guides we should go with. And I think we ended up going with Fuji.
Yeah. Just your basic on those, Fujis,
but
yeah.
As compared to a rod you just went and picked up at any
right.
any store or whatever, their guides are spaced further apart. There's less yep. guides, so you got less line contact to your rod. Yep. You know, and that was one of the things that you and I were going over, too, and that's why we ended up going with more guides and smaller guides, and yep. they worked out really good. I mean, the action on those trout rods.
And that's typically what I recommend to a lot of guys is, you know, you can get your factory recommendations, and I purposely say recommendations. Because every rod blank, when it's rolled, is a little bit different. And, you know, we'll take the factory guide spacing recommendations and then tape the guides on, double everything over, you know, put a weight or something on the end, and then just kind of watch, you know, how the line goes through. Basically, by adding a guide, you're reducing the flat spots in the line. It just winds up working out so much better,
mm-hmm.
you know, and like with yours, the smaller guides for, you know, your warm water stuff, it just seems to cast a little bit smoother to me,
yeah.
you know.
A little more accurately, too, yeah. I think.
It's
because honestly, that rod that Dustin got me for my wedding present, I was like, isn't this supposed to have bigger guides on the bottom of it? And then he explained it to me. I was like, oh, all right. I've never tried a rod like this.
Right.
And,
which, if that tells any of the listeners about Landon and I's relationship, I got him a fishing rod for his wedding gift. Sorry, Jen.
That is pretty awesome, I have to say.
It's a badass rod.
Oh, yeah.
And I've caught some huge fish on it. And I noticed a little bit when I started using it, I'm like, yeah, it actually kind of does seem a little bit more accurate. What I really noticed is when I broke it. No fault of Jake's. I usually only have a fishing rod for like about a year before I break it, as Dustin knows.
Yeah, you're the worst.
I'm hard on my stuff. But I went back to just using like my 7-foot Guide Series Gainer Mountain Rod,
right.
which for the money, they're great rods. But I couldn't hit those little pockets in those small streams yep. that I was fishing for big browns in, and it was frustrating.
Oh yeah.
So,
and then when you stretch it out, you know, going back to the closers, when you stretch it out on a big rod like that,
yeah,
you know, if you're losing line control as it's passing through your guides.
And that's the thing, is like almost every builder kind of has their own little quirks, I guess is the way to put it, on how they prefer to do it. You know, I just like running the smaller guys. I think basically the best way to explain this, there's, I think it's American Tackle makes them. They're called microwave guides. They've got a big ring and then a smaller ring inside of that. And basically what that does is when you make a cast, all of your line comes off in a big loop. So it hits that big ring and then goes into the small one, and it reduces that huge loop and comes out straighter. So A, it'll improve your casting distance, and B, it's supposed to make it more accurate.
Kind of funnels it down.
Exactly. Yeah, that is the exact, the perfect way to put it.
I watched some YouTube videos on those guides, actually, and it's really impressive.
Well,
I mean, they look really corny when you look at them.
Dude, they are bizarre looking. It's wild. Perfect example, that spider wrap bait caster that I just did for a buddy of mine. Most of the time with a bait caster, I don't know if you guys fish them very often or not. But
I used to when I bass fish a lot.
Usually you got to kind of keep your thumb on the spool.
Mm-hmm.
So he was real iffy about that guide at first. And that was just the first one that I put on there, and then just ran my regular guide train from there. But he stopped by so we could just load it up and make sure he was good with, you know, the way the spacing looked and all that. And he was casting that thing in the backyard with what he would typically run and hardly even had to thumb the spool. No backlash until it hit the ground.
Yeah.
I mean, it was just quite shocking, really.
Yeah.
So what kind of blank are you using for those bait caster ones?
That one that I did for him was the Lamglass Closer 10 to 17.
Okay.
Realistically, you can do it on just about anything.
Sure.
It just becomes more difficult.
Mm-hmm.
The lighter the rod, then the closer, the tighter you have to space everything on the bottom to get that rotation the right way. It just, those really light ones, it just looks bulky and it just doesn't, it doesn't look right.
Yeah.
You know, the heavier ones, it's a lot better. You know,
it
will look a little bit closer to what a factory rod's going to look like. It's just more aesthetically pleasing, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The main reason, though, that I want to go with those same guides, the recoils that come factory on the closer, is the way that they don't pick up ice.
Yeah.
The same as
No, they any don't pick up ice nearly as much, and with them being the full titanium, and they're very flexible.
Yeah.
So you literally can just take your finger on one of them guys and just kind of flick it, and that ice just gone.
Yeah, they almost, at first when I was using them, I'm like, man, they kind of seem kind of flimsy, but they're they're strong.
Well, they're just designed that way.
Right, they're just flexible.
Yeah.
It really surprised, I didn't notice until I was fishing with my friends, and they're like, man, I'm still icing up. I can't believe it's this cold out here still. And I'm like, I haven't had ice on my rod tip all day.
Yeah.
Now, granted, on Sunday when I was fishing, we got to the river and it was 10 degrees. Then I had icing problem, but there's not much you can do about that.
Oh, it's 10 degrees outside. That's unavoidable. I don't care how big a guy you run on the tip, you're still going to get ice in 10 degrees.
Yep. Yeah. So another thing we've got to figure out on this closer that I'm building is what I want for grips, reel seats.
Right.
I have the adjustable reel seat on my rod right now.
Oh, the sliding rings?
Mm-hmm. I like it. Seems to work good. I think the fixed ones are a little fancier. What type of seats are you usually putting on closers?
If it was going to be my rod, I'm going to have a custom acrylic or a dyed stabilized wood every single time. You know, they're kind of tapered. They recess right into the foregrip. They're just comfortable. And luckily, I met a guy that lives out in New York that turns everything down, cuts the mortise, you know, so your reel actually fit into the reel seat itself, and matching butt cap and all that stuff. Like, guy just does awesome work.
Yeah. So even that's completely custom.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's the beauty of it. I mean, I've had a couple rods where a guy just gives me a color scheme and I get an acrylic blank made and it's the exact colors that he wanted. Jeff turns it down for me. Turns out great.
Yeah, I've seen some of the ones you posted, and they're, I mean, one of the biggest reasons you want a custom rod is, one, you can have it built exactly the way you want,
right,
but two, you can have something that's sweet looking.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. That's kind of the way I look at it. If you're going to pay the money to have a custom rod built, why would you not do something that you're not going to see on the river?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. For how much time you spend out there doing it, sure, a pretty rod's not going to catch more fish, but
right.
No, but
I like the way they look.
Yeah. I also think that, you know, there's a weird little thing in the back of your head where a fancy looking rod like that gives you just that smidge of extra confidence.
Hey, and that
can make the difference.
That can, because if you lose confidence, I've done it a lot of times when I've been out on the river and you lose confidence and it gets tough to focus.
It snowballs.
Yep. And one bad thing leads to the next. You get snagged up. All of a sudden you're like, that's it. I'm not retiring.
I can't tell you how many days I've done that, man.
But you got to, that's a few weeks ago when we went out that day I was telling you about, we went like 1 for 9 and had everything from the hook break into everything in between losing fish. And it was just like an awful, it was a great day of fishing, could have been a great day of fishing, but too many things went wrong. And we were almost to the boat launch and all of us had like gotten snagged up and we're like, that's it. We're just paddling out of here. It's almost dark. We're done. And then we got to one more hole and we're like, all right, fine, let's just all retie. And we all ended up hooking into one more fish and caught one and a little skip or two. So hey,
it's that last cast theory, man.
Yeah. Yeah. One last cast, 45 casts later, it's usually.
Exactly.
Usually what it is. That trout rod that you built for me, where you put Lifestyle Lost on the rod itself, is that like, is that a decal?
Yeah, it's just a vinyl decal.
Okay.
Like I said, I have spent way too much money on a vinyl cutter for another business a couple of years ago and can still use it for that type of stuff. So it's been kind of nice to have around. I mean, that's just one more added thing that you can do to a custom rod that you're not going to get that off the shelf.
Yeah. Yeah, it looks sweet too. So really, if anybody has anything they want to put on a rod, if they own a business, if it's a gift for somebody, you could do a custom.
To an extent. I mean, the only bad thing about that vinyl cutter is it's a die cut system, basically. So anything that's any kind of variegated color or anything along those lines, I'd have to basically contract that out.
Okay.
Luckily, a good buddy of mine works at a sign shop and can get pretty much anything done. It's just some of those little tiny little letters. It just doesn't go well when you're trying to cut that.
Yeah. Did you cut the ones on my rod on there? I mean, those are pretty small, so.
Yeah, and let me just tell you, it was not fun getting the excess vinyl off of that and making it look right. Oh, my God.
Good job, Dustin.
Hey, I do vividly remember offering to do that.
He offered, yeah. Yeah.
So that'll be a little bit.
That was my own fault.
That's why yours has it and mine doesn't.
I'll post some pictures of it on Instagram and Facebook too, so people can see what we're saying. But a great, awesome gift idea though. If you're, making one for somebody.
No fisherman's gonna be upset about a custom rod getting built for him.
No.
You know, a good buddy of mine, his wife had me build a steelhead rod for him for Christmas this year. Which, granted, it didn't get done by Christmas with the boys being born and all that good stuff.
Yeah, because your kids were born in December?
Yeah, December 18th.
Okay.
Yeah.
Probably threw a wrench in a few Christmas plans, I imagine.
Oh, man, yeah, they threw a wrench in everything.
What, another thing that I really like about your odds is the custom wraps that you do, the thread wraps.
Right.
You do some really unique designs.
He did tiger wraps on both of our trout rods.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And realistically, like when I first started doing this, I looked at tiger wraps and we're like, oh my God, those look so difficult. And then I kind of progressed through this to the closed wraps where you literally have to have your measurements down to a fraction of millimeters in order for everything to close the right way.
Yeah.
So perfect example. Started one a couple weeks ago, got about 80% through it. Probably 6 or 7 hours into it. Looked at it the one day and went, this thing is not going to close. Had to cut the entire thing off and start over again.
Oh, no.
About made me cry.
So what is the process for doing those wraps? Are you doing that by hand, like wrapping it around the rod? Or?
Yeah, like I...
You'll have to kind of...
Because I have the power wrapper, which basically has belt driven. So I'll get my measurements all figured out on the zero axis and the 180 axis, and then you have to take in the taper offset, which basically any decent fishing rod you're going to come across, the bottom of it is going to be a little bit thicker than where you end that wrap.
Yeah.
So in order to accommodate for that, to make sure that the threads close on anything, there's a few of them that it'll still work and you don't have to do that, but you have to, trying to think of the best way to explain this. Basically, you have to account for the smaller diameter at the end of the wrap versus the bigger at the end, and again, fractions of millimeters in order for everything to close up right.
So basically, you're putting, I'm putting
two-way tape right by where the grip is, and then one at the end, and I got my cross points for the marks that I need. You have a pattern, or, you know, some of these guys do it off of their head. I don't understand how some of these guys do it without a pattern. It's just crazy to me. But you're literally taking your wrap, your thread, putting it in a fly tying bobbin. That's how I like to do it.
Okay.
Starting at one end and wrapping and hitting those cross points on the way up and on the way back down. And just over and over and over and over and over until that thread forms a pattern and closes any kind of gaps. The amount of time that it takes is absurd, and my wife thinks I'm insane for doing it.
I think you just posted one that was like orange and...
Yep. Like gray. Orange lamb of glass, yeah. It was orange, gunsmoke, and black.
How long does something like that take you, just for the wraps?
For the deck wrap, I had easily seven and a half hours into it. Just because it was a double pattern. I mean,
okay,
that makes it a lot more difficult. You know, you can... It's one of those million ways to skin a cat kind of deal.
Yeah.
You know, you can... Like I said, it's just kind of hard to explain.
Yeah.
There's so much that goes into it, and...
Imagine it's very tedious work.
You have no idea. You sit there for, like I said, 6, 7, 8 hours, just staring down at one little point, and if you're off by 2 millimeters somewhere, you're starting over.
And when you care about what you do... Yeah. And the looks of it that you're putting out.
Yeah, I mean, if I'm building a rod for somebody else, like, I'm not going to give them something subpar. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, if there's little stuff in there that would bug me, I'm starting over.
Yeah.
And I'm way more anal about this than I should be, but...
I've heard some other people say that about you, and it's a good thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're like, Jake's good, but man, his wraps are, like, pretty intense. They're some of the best...
I mean, you got to take pride in what you do.
Yeah.
I mean, this isn't a full-time job for me by any means, but,
right.
You know, I enjoy doing it. That's the biggest thing. And it doesn't bother me as much as it should when I put all that time in and have to cut it off and start over. Just
see, because, that would drive me bonkers. I am not the type of person that has the patience for that.
Yeah, when that happened a couple weeks ago, I walked upstairs, told my wife that, and she just was like, oh, God, here we go.
She's like, well, I'm going to go to bed.
Yeah. She's like, I'm sorry. It's not that big of a deal. I mean, I don't want to put that out there.
Yeah, you got to expect that it's going to happen at some point, I guess. Yep.
Definitely happens.
So now cork. We were talking about what I'm going to do for the handle, if I'm going to do cork or do a fiberglass wrap, like...
Oh, the carbon fiber?
Yeah, the carbon fiber wrap, not fiberglass. Are there any advantages or disadvantages to either one?
Personal opinion, I find carbon fiber to be superior, you know, from the standpoint of if you're doing a lot of winter fishing, mm-hmm. It stays warmer than cork.
Yeah, and it does.
So
I've noticed that
makes a huge difference. And then, like, my walleye jigging rods, I mean, it transfers the vibration of when a fish hits so much more than what cork does.
Yeah.
I mean, in comparison, cork, it's almost like it just dampens it.
Right,
I mean, truly, it shocked me the first time that I fished a rod like that, that had the carbon fiber
in it. And that's why you see, like, a lot of bass rods and stuff will actually have the cutout and have the actual blank exposed, so you can feel it. With your finger. Now, I would say, like, for pin fishing, your bobber fishing, probably not that big of a deal.
No, the sensitivity for
but
that is...
like, you're talking about walleye fishing, you're jigging, you want to feel
every little thing, or even if you're bottom bouncing for steelhead, you know, same kind of thing. I just find it to be superior, and I don't know. So some of them just little, tiny little ticks.
Yeah.
That you might not feel with cork, you... pick up on it with a fiber handle.
Yeah, I think, like, if I had a bass or a walleye rod, especially, you know, if I was doing deeper water fishing, slower fishing, I'd definitely probably go that route. I think I'm going to go to cork this time just because they look sweet and they're comfortable
to
hold on to. We were texting back and forth the other day. What was that called? The designs you do in the cork?
Oh, the chevrons or herringbones?
Yeah. Yeah.
Depends on what you want to call it. Basically, there's a couple of pictures of it on my Facebook page. Basically, you just have two angles that come to a point within the grip facing one way or another.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're an absolute nightmare to make, but they look cool.
So the cork handles, do you turn them all down?
Yeah, I got a lathe.
You put them all on essentially square.
Yeah, like I'll glue everything up. You know, you're just using cork rings basically.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you put those EVA inlays, then those wind up being square. So I have to run those through the bandsaw and just cut the edges off and then put them on the lathe and just rough turn everything down. Then you're going with sandpaper and going through 3 and 4 different grits up to, it's either 400 or 600 that I usually use just to finish it off. Just makes it really smooth.
Yeah.
And then from there, you have to remount the inside so it'll actually slide all the way down to blank, because typically your cork rings that you can commercially buy are readily available. They only have a 1/4-inch hole on the inside. And some of these huge rods,
yeah,
especially like the Lamaglass closers, you know, whether they got the fiberglass sleeve along the bottom, I mean, mm-hmm. the diameter of those is just insane. Like I did one last week. That red rod that I was just showing you guys.
Oh, yeah.
Basically got the entire grip done, went to remount the inside of it, and it exploded. So,
the cork.
Yeah.
Oh,
like,
man.
Broke into 4 different pieces. That was one where I wanted to cry. You know, you spend 2 days waiting for your epoxy to set up, and then you're starting over. Oh. It was not a good night.
So how long does it take to build a rod? Let's say you only had one to build. Okay. You know, you're not building a bunch of rods for a bunch of different people. You're just going to build one rod for yourself. You have all the time in the world to do it, start to finish. How long does that process take?
That's hard to say.
Because you got a lot of, like, drying time. And
right. Because, I mean, typically turn my own carbon fiber handles versus buying the ones that are out there. I mean,
yeah.
CFX makes really nice grips, but the other part about a custom rod is you want everything to your specific length. You know, your arm is probably not the same length as mine.
Right.
So what's comfortable for you might not be comfortable for me. So typically with that, you have your foam core, and you're putting in a layer of epoxy, and then you basically have the carbon fiber sleeves that are essentially a Chinese finger trap. Mm-hmm. So you got to scrunch those down, put them on there after you put the epoxy on the core, stretch them tight, tape off the ends, and then those are drying for 24 hours. Once those are done, you're putting your butt cap on, reaming out your grips, putting that on. Depending on what kind of deck wrap you want to do. I mean, realistically, if I didn't have twin boys and could sit down in my basement building these rods for 6-7 hours a day, I could probably get one done in 4 or 5 days, but I can't really do that anymore.
No, I mean, I'm just trying to give people an idea for like how much work actually goes into one of these, because we've talked a little bit about it before, and had, you know,
I mean, there's ways.
Before I talked to you, I figured like, oh, you could probably build one in a day.
Yeah.
But there's so much hurry up and wait going on.
Right.
You know, and you get this part done. And
a lot of what takes the longest is your epoxy finish. I mean, it's just your 2-part of finish that's 24 hours for it to be set up hard enough. You know, sometimes you can get away with 2 coats, but typically I like to run 3 just because it saturates better, comes up with a better, smoother finish. There's ways you can kind of cut that down. But, you know, your 5-minute epoxy is not going to have as good of a bond as what a 24-hour is going to have. So, you know, for cork grips, you're gluing each cork ring together, compressing everything, making sure that there's no gaps or anything. 24 hours on that. You know, 24 hours each coat of finish, 24 hours after you actually get the cork grip done, put it on the blank itself. I mean,
And that's not taking into consideration time to set the guides and
exactly.
wrap and all
you know,
of that.
You can, once you wrap your guides on, you got to make sure they're all straight.
Yeah.
You know, that's obviously the biggest thing, you know.
Right.
I couldn't imagine paying the money that some of these guys are paying me to build rods and getting them in their hands and going, oh my God, these guides aren't straight.
Yeah. Yeah. No way.
That's just unacceptable.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, you're talking about how much money these cost, but honestly, they're not really ridiculously priced compared to what you're paying for a factory rod.
No, I mean, a lot of times we can build them close to what the factory price is.
Right.
I mean, the biggest thing is just how fancy you want to get with thread work.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
if you want someone to spend 7 hours
exactly,
doing
if
a wrap.
You want me to sit there for 6-7 hours doing a wrap, like, you're going to pay for it.
Sure. Yeah.
And that's understandable.
Yep.
I mean, and if you don't want to pay somebody to do that, that's what production rods are for.
Yep. A lot of pretty sweet stuff you can do with them, though. I'm excited. We'll have to. Do you have like magazines or catalogs or websites you can kind of flip through and look at different ideas?
Usually, as far as getting ideas, no. But there's so many unbelievable rod builders out there that, you know, look through their Instagrams or anything like that. I mean, the guys over on the East Coast, you know, your Billy Vivonas, your Mary Christie and her husband Wes, like the thread work that these guys do is incredible. You know, it's kind of nice though, because it gives people like me something to strive for.
Yeah.
You know, it's
artwork.
It really is. And that's
what it all comes down
to. You know,
to.
I look at mine in comparison to theirs and go, oh my God, I'm never going to get there.
But it's like you were saying too, at first when you started looking at some of these, you didn't think you can do them, you're doing them now. So.
Right. I mean, it's just a progression. I mean, realistically, I've only been doing this for 3 years and I'm figuring out the closed wraps and all this crazy complicated stuff that I couldn't have fit into my head 3 years ago. And now it's just like, oh, okay, that's not that bad.
Yeah. So if somebody wants to get in touch with you, how do they get in touch with you to get rods built?
The best thing and what's easiest for me to keep track of is through my Facebook business page, Two Track Custom Rod Design. That is the easiest thing to do. You know, I've got a lot of pictures and stuff out there too that they can look through and, you know, kind of get some ideas and, you know, at least get a rough idea of what they want.
Yeah.
Like I said, that's the easiest way and the easiest way for me to stay organized.
Yeah, I keep everything in one place, all the messages
exactly.
and everything.
Exactly.
Makes sense.
You know, when you got your Facebook messenger, your business page, your text messages, phone calls, it's like
your work email.
It's just a nightmare to keep track of some days.
Absolutely. So you getting excited about getting out and doing some fishing soon? We should be in full swing steelhead season here.
Yeah, it's coming.
About three or four days.
Yeah. Struck a little deal with the wife, so I gotta get some stuff done around the house. And
that's important to do.
Honey-do list is
exactly. Get the honey-do list done, and I'll get out hopefully this weekend and see what happens. I mean, water levels should be coming down to a point where they're wadeable.
Yeah, as long as we don't get a bunch more rain.
Yeah.
For anybody listening, when we're recording this, it's what, March 18th?
Yep.
Yeah. Along day along before along. Dustin's birthday.
Oh, yeah.
So.
I'll be an old fart tomorrow.
Yeah. A lot of times we're either like fishing or hunting or something on your birthday. We have been a couple
lately
times.
We've been steelhead fishing on my birthday.
Yeah.
This year, however, I will be at the Secretary of State and then going to work.
You wait till the last minute to renew all your plates and stuff?
Of course I do.
Yeah. Usually I wait until like a couple weeks later, so I got to pay like $10 more.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, it's better than what I used to do. I'd wait till I got my taxes back. Usually about 4 months after my birthday.
It's better than waiting until you get pulled over.
Oh,
it's actually not that expensive because I did that before too. So
it happened to me one time and it was not a fun ticket, not a real fun experience in general.
It's like $140 and plus you got to register your car. So
yeah, well, I got my car searched for no reason, so that was that was interesting.
Depending on what stage of your life you're in, maybe that wasn't a good thing.
Yeah.
No. I'm just kidding. Yeah, I think I'm going to get out. Well, I know I'm going to get out this weekend. But I'm on dog watching duty. It's the wife's weekend to do some fun things, so it won't be as much. But
yeah,
full day, like this weekend,
I'm looking at Sunday, man. Sunday should be... Yeah. Sunday's looking pretty good.
Yeah. Saturday or Sunday is supposed to be 50s for the most
both
part.
It is, yeah.
Can't complain about that. If you go steelhead fishing this coming weekend, what do you think is going to be the ticket to be using? Do you think you're starting to get into running spawn, or jigs and wax worms still going to work? Or
That's hard to say. It's really kind of water temperature dependent, in my opinion.
That water is cold.
I mean, if it's real cold, jigs and wax worms typically are going to be good.
Yeah.
The water was still only, what, like 38 degrees this weekend?
Oh, it had to be colder than that with all the melt on top of that snow. It was probably coming in just about freezing. Yeah,
I think.
There was slush on the surface of the river when we got there this weekend. It was also 10 degrees, though.
I think I saw Thursday or Friday the water temp was like 36 or 38. But by Saturday and Sunday when the temps dropped again, I bet it got real cold because the nights were freezing.
Now, a few weeks ago, I did see some polished up gravel and stuff in the river, so
doesn't surprise me.
You never know.
Early run fish that come in just
been there,
get it done. Get a little temperature spike, like, okay, let's do this.
Yeah. What is that temperature? Usually like 40, 42 they start?
Something along those lines. I mean, river to river it can vary.
Now once fish get into full spawn mode here in a couple weeks and there's a lot of fish on gravel, obviously those ones aren't too interested in biting usually. Usually focus more around like the dark water around those holes.
Dark water between gravel runs with beads.
Beads.
Yeah. Tailing back behind.
Bent my by far top producer. I mean, it's soft seams, especially once they spawn and I mean they're tired.
Drop
back. They're gonna kinda start dropping back and staying in those little slack pools, and you know, if you can't see them, they can't see you, you're having a lot better chance than standing there raking gravel.
Yeah. Are you a natural bead color guy, or do you use the bright greens? And
I was very much a natural color bead guy until this last year when I finally picked up some of those slaying steel beads, that UV starburst, that really bright with orange specks.
Yeah.
It seems was to be the just ticket. Dumb.
Yeah.
The one day that we went and fished over in the Grand. I mean, I was running the normal stuff that I usually run, never touched the fish the whole day.
No.
Switched to one of those, and it just got stupid.
You think it was just something where, I mean, it was the Grand Dirty, usually it's pretty dirty.
Yeah, I think that was a lot of it.
You think that's part of it?
That was, like, thinking back on it, that was the only bead that we'd even touched a fish on that day.
I've had days like that, you know, where you... Yeah. Fish everything, all of a sudden you put a different color on, and that seems to be the ticket.
Exactly. And that day, that's exactly what it was.
Yeah. I mean, keep switching if you're not catching fish, that's for sure.
And you know, when you start,
especially if you know there's fish there.
Yeah. If you know there's fish there, start with two different ones sometimes.
Yeah.
Let the fish tell you what they want.
Yeah.
That's typically the program we usually run. And you know, sometimes a change from a 10 mil to an 8 mil can make a difference. Or going from an 8 mil to a 10 mil, depending on water clarity. You know, one little adjustment like that can make the difference between a terrible day and a great day.
Do you run double bead rigs?
A lot of the time, yeah. I mean, especially if you're float fishing. I mean, I don't see why not, as long as the river allows it.
In the bigger rivers?
Yeah.
Now, what if you're in some of the smaller rivers where you're only fishing, you know, 4 to 6 foot holes?
Yeah, I'll still do it a lot of the time.
Yeah.
What do you like between like a plastic or a glass bead? I've heard different guys talk about how the bead like flows in the water differently, obviously.
Yeah, the glass is going to be a little bit heavier. That day that I was just talking about, we were fishing the Grand, we were running a glass bead up top and just one of those slain steel beads on the bottom. Mm-hmm. And it almost seemed like the glass bead helped get that bottom bead, the hot bead, down
a little bit
faster. So, you know, once we kind of switched to that program, it was just almost one after the other.
And yeah.
It was so dumb.
I think guys that aren't catching a lot of fish that are fishing rivers with fish in them, I think that's one thing that a lot of people get really worried about, is like snagging up on the bottom and not keeping their
bait or gear where
it needs to be for fish.
Those fish are going to hang as close to any kind of structure as they can get. Yep. I mean,
you got to get it in their strike
zone. You got to get it where they're at, period.
Yep. Yep. They're not going to come up 3 feet to chase a little tiny bead going
and
by.
Realistically, beads and hooks are cheap.
Yeah.
Who cares if you lose a couple?
Yeah.
Yep. You know?
Well, and I mean, if you're fishing one run and you keep lowering it down, lowering it down, lowering it down, and then all of a sudden you get snagged up and break off. Well, if you paid attention to how deep you were, bring it up 4 inches from there and you're good to go.
Exactly. Right? And then you're right in their wheelhouse.
Yep.
You know, we've had that happen so many days where you're not doing anything the entire day. Slide your float up 3 inches and then it's bam, 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 bam. You can't do anything wrong.
Yeah. Yep, can't be afraid to lose gear, that's for sure.
No.
The other thing we need to figure out is we need to figure out another day to put on the calendar to go do some mousing again. Oh, that was awesome. Yeah.
That's my jam, dude. There is no other way I'd rather fish.
Yeah.
I mean, those explosive takes, when you can't see your hand in front of your face, there is nothing better than that.
You took my place that night. Why couldn't I go?
I don't know. Probably some bullshit excuse like usual.
But yet again, it was the most fish I've landed in a night. So
we had
the dust and luck strikes again.
I lost. Do this for you guys.
I missed a couple fish, hooked a fish for a second and lost it.
Yep.
You caught two. I can't remember if we had any other blow-ups or not. But
I know Kent had a couple blow-ups that night, and I think I missed one or two.
And then you caught that fish, dropped it in the river, and I snagged it.
Oh, my God, dude.
Not literally snagged it, but reached in and grabbed it.
I was so happy about that.
In the dark, just complete blind.
We need,
we
need to get up there a couple of times this year. And
yeah, that's a lot of fun. And
we should try to find a weekend and just do like a Friday,
Saturday
night.
I've wanted to do that for so many years, but it's so hard to talk somebody into wading down a river they don't know at 2 o'clock in the morning when they can't see anything in front of their face and just waiting for the sound of a toilet flushing.
Well, we could fish some bigger stretches out of the boat too.
Yeah. Hey, if you're comfortable rowing, I'm not doing it.
I would do it up there.
Yeah.
Where we,
yeah.
I did the PM this year with one of my buddies and that was sketchy.
Mousin?
Yeah.
Yeah, that is brave.
It was
by the time you know what you're floating into.
Oh, we were hitting trees and stuff nonstop.
Yeah.
Nonstop. Yeah. But he's got a nice stealth craft boat. The river wasn't raging. It was pretty low.
Dude,
so
the PM sketches me out during the daylight. I can't imagine doing that at night.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
We had a couple close calls in our old boat and rowing that thing at night. Not something I really want to do.
You gotta really know the river.
Right.
And we would turn our headlamps on so we could see where we were going and stuff too. And I know you're a no lights at all kind of guy.
Yeah.
But
like, I mean, there's
I've fished with other people that they don't really think it bothers them that much.
Yeah.
But if you're going down the PM at night when you're moving, especially in the faster water, you probably need to turn a light on.
Yeah. And a lot of guys swear by the super dark, you know, no moonlight or anything.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the best days I've had were when it was full moon or three-quarter moon. You know, if those fish are hungry and they see that big mouse skating over the top of them and they want it, it doesn't matter if it's light or not.
Yeah.
In my opinion, my hookup ratio is better when it's brighter out.
Yeah,
I think those fish
can
track that mouse.
Well, I was just going to say, they can probably track it way better, so their strike is much more on point.
Well, and it's not, they're not guessing.
Yeah.
They know right where it's at.
Yep.
You know, those two that I got when we went, there was no doubt.
They're on.
Yeah.
That one you caught too, you said, this is the hole where that big one lives that I've been trying to get.
I have hooked a fish, a very large fish, out of that same exact hole 3 years in a row. And he whooped my ass every single time. But I got him this year. That was the one that I was holding and dropped. And then next thing I know, Landon comes up with a fish in his hands. I'm like, yes, you're my hero.
That's awesome.
Yeah, because pictures are, it didn't happen. So
no.
And we had no pictures yet.
And it, you know, at the time I was okay with it. But now looking back at it, it's like, I'm really glad I have those pictures.
Yeah. That was a nice fish too. It was like 22, 23 inches or something.
Yeah, 22, 23-ish. I don't even remember. I don't think we had, did we have a tape?
I don't know. I don't think we did.
That was a nice fish though.
Yeah. And it was just,
you could tell it was big and healthy.
Yeah. The way that it played out was just funny.
Yeah.
As I'm walking down, I look back at him. I go, well, let's see if Grandpa's still here.
That's sweet.
Yeah. That was a good one.
You can't draw it up like that very often.
No. Like I said, it just played out so perfectly.
Yeah. For sure. It was like your big brown from the summer.
That thing gave me a heart attack. I didn't talk at all when I hooked that fish.
Well, when you got quiet, I knew. When you got quiet, I turned and looked at you, and I could see you were hooked up, and then I turned back. And all you could see, you know, when you hook those browns like that, when you first see them flash, they just look like bright orange. Mm-hmm. And all you could see was that just big thing just going like, woof, woof, just bending back and forth on the water.
I don't think I breathed until I landed that fish. Usually if I hook a big fish, I'm like, oh, it's a nice one. It's a nice one.
Right.
We might annoy people when if they ever fish with us, but we get pretty amped up.
Yeah. I get excited.
The whole point of it is to have fun.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah,
it's ridiculous if somebody gets like mad at you about that. Yeah. You know?
That one and my 24 and a quarter that I caught here this fall, those were both caught on those rods you built with.
Yeah, if you were like within a mile of us, you could have heard us yelling about that fish. Yeah.
Well, you saw me that night. I mean, I was standing there just like shaking for like 10 minutes.
and that's all it takes. I mean, you can fish hours and hours and hours, and if that's the only fish you catch,
right,
it was totally worth it.
Well, I mean, same thing that night. We went probably 5 miles downstream in pitch black and then went through this one
little stretch.
Tiny little stretch that was
an overlooked
15
spot.
15 feet wide.
It's really what it is, I would say.
15 feet wide, probably tops.
Yeah.
And then I got that one. Then you guys had two more boils a little bit further down.
Just right down from where you got that one. I had another one slap at it.
That's the thing. Some of those super overlooked places hold the biggest fish.
Yeah.
Because they don't.
And
nobody targets them in there.
What I've learned is those fish will hit multiple times lot of times. I hooked into a really big fish, fishing with Brian Kosminski that I lost right at the boat, but I think it hit like 5 or 6 times before it finally took.
Yeah, it was 2 summers ago. That same little stretch that me and you and Kent went down, right as you're getting down towards that bridge, there was a fish that boiled on that mouse 4 different times. Finally got it on the 5th time, and when I got down to where he took it, it was less than 6 inches deep, and that fish hit it 5 different times. Which is ridiculous.
Yeah,
that's insane.
Just the predatory instinct of those big browns, they're just awesome.
Yeah, I'm addicted.
There's not much like it.
I love steelhead fishing, and steelhead will put up some of the best fights of your life.
Right.
But the actual act of steelhead fishing is much more boring than fishing for browns, whether you're streamer fishing or throwing Rapalas or mousing.
I think there's something to be said about like getting into some of those nasty little holes with streams that are, you know,
you can't get a boat
10,
in there.
12 feet wide.
Yeah.
The only way to fish it is to just like grind through it, and you're waist deep in that silty muck sometimes, and your boots are filled up and your toes are smashed in the end of your boots. And
if you're not frustrated most of the time, then you're probably not in a good spot.
Yeah. How many times have we been up north brook trout fishing, and every time we're halfway in and we're like, why do we do this?
Why are we in here?
Why are we in here?
And then you see that one like 18 inch brown
and
come out.
And that's the thing, brookie makes your day.
Yep.
We never actually catch the real big ones. Well, you caught some big ones this year.
Hey, this, you got that.
I caught 2 the last 2 years, which is just
huge. What were those?
They're the big female that I caught, not this past summer, but the fall before. She was right at 16. And that fish I have on my wall, I couldn't revive her, unfortunately. And then the fish I caught last year, right towards the end of season, was a big male, and he was 16 and a half.
And then in that same stretch of
river, my uncle pulled one out that was 18 last year.
To put that in perspective, though, he's been fishing hard his entire life. And how old is your uncle? He's older than your dad.
Oh, yeah, he's 67 or so.
He's been fishing hard for brook trout his whole life.
He still fishes hard.
His biggest one.
He still fishes hard.
That's awesome. Yeah. I'm just hoping that I can be doing it at that age.
I know, me too.
Just never stop.
The day I can't ever walk down a river, I don't want to be alive anymore.
Yep. I agree with you.
Yep.
For sure. So, Andy, we got any other things we got to talk about here, guys?
Nah, not that I can think of.
No.
I'm going to have to think about getting one of those closers here soon.
It's well, once you picked mine up, you're like, okay.
It was a total difference.
Yeah.
Because I've I've spin fished for steelhead forever.
That's how I've always done it.
And I use a big long rod and stuff like that, but I'm using a spinning reel.
Yeah.
And that, yeah, when was it? Back in February here. Yeah.
January. Yeah.
Yeah, we floated the PM. And we just happened to be on a stretch, and I set my rod down and grabbed his, and I just started chucking that. I'm like, this is a whole different ball game, man.
They're nice.
That's what they're built for.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Float fishing.
Yeah.
And they're designed by one of the best steelhead fishermen you're going to come across in the state.
Yeah. Yeah.
You had him on, Roger. You know?
Yeah. Actually, just did another podcast. They'll probably be releasing that one before this one, so be a little out of order.
Yeah.
But we did one on plug-in too. His ability to explain things. And he doesn't just say, this is how you do it, or this is how I like to do it. He's always got a backstory. It's this is how you do it, and this is why I think that. There was this study down that I read, and then I've seen this for myself. There's always a bunch of factors that come into why he's doing something, not just like, well, you want to fish this close to the bottom because it works. You know, it's much more detailed.
Right.
It's not on a whim.
I wish I could articulate.
Oh, yeah.
He's how to do things the way
very good he does. At that type of thing. I mean, I've had conversations with him where he's kind of broke down why he did what he did with the closer design and the reasoning behind it. And I mean, some of the stuff he was telling me just blew my mind.
Yeah.
You know, stuff that I never would have thought of.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, he's a very impressive guy to talk to.
Yeah.
And in my opinion, he's the nicest guy I've come across in the fishing
he's
industry.
He's got time for everybody.
Exactly.
I don't know how he does
it. I've never even met the guy face to face, but he answers my phone calls every time I call him.
Yep.
And if he can't, then I at least get a text, hey, I'm in the middle of this, can I call you back later? You know, you don't get that from a lot of these guys that are professionals in the industry.
No, I mean, he's good at what he does, but he also cares about it a lot too.
Exactly.
Where, you know, you have some guys that are really, really good.
He's got a passion for it.
Exactly.
And that,
he's got a passion for helping other people
exactly.
do it too. That's what really impresses me, I guess.
Yep. But guys like that are few and far between anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And the guys that are there are the ones that are changing the industry and innovating and, you know what I mean, making it better for everybody else.
Yep.
Yep. There's a lot of guys that know what they're doing out there and they don't care to let anybody else know.
Exactly.
Right? And I don't think that's a... I'm the same way sometimes.
From a pocketbook perspective, probably a good way to go about it, but.
Yeah, I'm not going to share my favorite spots. I'm not going to share my favorite spots, but you want everybody to catch fish, just not on the river you're on.
Right, exactly.
That's not what I do.
Exactly.
It's two types of fishermen, the guys you're with and those other assholes.
Yep, that's true.
That's the truth.
Yep.
All right. Well, I appreciate you letting us come in and check out the facility, the rod building factory. And
anytime, man.
We'll get to figuring out what I'm doing with this next rod.
Sounds good.
Thanks for being on.
Yeah, thanks for having me on, man.